So did you work with the Beatles again?
Yeah, I did actually, because another situation where I got a call on a Friday evening. Everything happens on a Friday evening with me for some reason. I don't know why. And it was the management for the Beatles, and it wasn't very long after, in fact, a Magical Mystery Tour. And they said, Paul would like to have a chat with you. Can you come over to Abbey Road? Because they wanted to complete a film for Hey Jude. Well, I knew about this because it was actually being recorded in the studio in St Anne's Court, where I was working up the top floor editing commercials. And I'd gone down there and heard Paul playing it. So I went over to Abbey Road and saw Paul, and he said, look, he said, we want you to direct this film for us, Hey Jude. I said, well, that's great, because I'd heard the song, and it was a fantastic song. He said, well, the only thing is, he says, we want some sort of prison setting for it. So I said, okay. So he got me a copy of the record, which wasn't going to be released for at least a month anyway. I took it home, and I played it and played it the whole weekend and wore out the record, because in those days it was a 45 RPM disc. And I wrote the lyrics down and in one column, and I wrote all my visual ideas down in another column. And I was very happy with it. It was about a 5-page document. And on the Monday morning, over the weekend also, I'd rung up a producer that I'd been working with in commercials, told him all about it, and I said, we have to go to the Apple offices on Monday and start setting this up. So he came with me there, and we had a production office. And throughout the morning, we started looking at locations for prisons, to get in costumes for the Beatles. We got all the measurements and various other requirements for crew and so forth. But I had said to Paul, what's the running time of this song? He said 7 minutes. And I said, well, you know, 7 minutes is difficult to complete in one day. Generally, if you get 3 minutes of screen time in a day, that's good. So you could be looking at 2 days working through. And then suddenly in the afternoon, one of their management team come in and said, hold on everything, because they're not going to do it. I said, well, why? He said, I don't know why, but they're not going to do it. Okay, so we had to stop there. So I thought, well, what are they going to do? I heard no more. And the next thing, a few weeks later, is they're filming at Twickenham Studios. And they've got, if anyone's seen the film, it's a shot of Paul on the piano singing the song, and you're held on him and the Beatles. And then at the final chorus, where you go, da 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 da, Hey Jude, and it goes on for another few minutes. The lights come on. It's an audience of about 100 people, which they'd pulled in from Twickenham, around Twickenham, to sing. And that was it. It was quite simple, whereas my script was really involved and had a proper storyline to it, and would have been so much more rewarding for them to have in their catalogue, but was more filmic than just, you know, a crew, an audience in a studio. And I thought, well, they've done this because they shot this in a day. But some years later, I was talking to the producer, and he said, no, we took 2 days to shoot that. So with all of it, all in all, they took 2 days. And the script is still, you know, I still have the script. And I look at it now, and I've seen Hey Jude again, and my script is 10 times better than what they got there on the screen. And I just wish they would have taken the time. They didn't even see the script. They didn't even know what I created. That, I feel, was their loss, really, because I know it would have been good.
You worked with Paul McCartney in later years?
Yeah, that's right, I did. We got on very well together. And when Paul recorded the album Ram, which he shot some promos in Scotland with his wife Linda, he asked me to edit the film for them. And it was very, very, very good material, actually, of him and Linda on horses riding across the hilltops on their farm in Scotland. So that was really good. And then later on, he formed Wings, also with Linda and Denny Lane. And I edited a couple of promos for him then. It always took me back to wishing that they had
seen Hey Jude and always have wished that we could have completed that.
So I understand you did some sort of charitable kind of projects with UNICEF?
Yeah, I did actually. They were very rewarding. Again, I got a call from a French producer I worked with previously, and he said to me, can you come out to Las Vegas and work with Jerry Lewis? So I said, so you're talking about Jerry Lewis, the comedian, my idol? He said, we're talking about Jerry Lewis, the director. He said, there's a series of UNICEF films that have been made. I'd like you to come out there. Yeah, of course I can. Can I fly out Sunday? I said, oh, okay. So the game was, I think, on a Thursday or a Friday. You don't get much time in the film industry, so make up your mind. And he said, well, where would you like to stay? So I said, oh, Caesar's Palace. So the best hotel in Vegas. And so I went out there, and first of all, I had to stop off at Los Angeles to pick up equipment. And then I flew down to Vegas and arrived there at Jerry's office. And Jerry was wonderful. We'd been warned, both his assistant and myself, that Jerry was really a tough taskmaster. We were going to have a bit of a hard job here. So I said, let's see. It turned out absolutely the opposite. He couldn't be nicer. He was a fabulous person. He was very rewarding and just a dream to work with, I must say. And of course, my admiration was so high. But actually, they converted one of his offices into an editing room. We were waiting for the equipment to arrive from LA, and he sat down and chatted with us and was very personal about everything. And he told us a story about a movie of his that had never been made. And it was called The Day That the Clown Cried. And it's very, very touching. It's a film that he directed. He hadn't written the script on this one. And it was a story about a clown who gets drunk one day in Germany and blasphemes at a picture of Hitler. And they take him to the concentration camp. And they make it his job is to clown the children with the children and lead them into the gas chambers, which was a terrifying story. But a story so true, it had to be told. So I said to Jerry, well, why hasn't this film come out? He says, I don't think it's ever gonna come out, Roy. So I said, why? He said, because there's contractual problems with it. He said, the writer, who's Swedish, is not happy about the film being made, this, that, and the other. And he said, we can't get the rights on it to clear for screening, even though they had an edited version of the film. So I said, I'm in Europe, Jerry. I said, give me a chance. Can I have a chance to try and contact people out there? He said, Roy, I've tried everything. I've absolutely tried everything, legally and whatever. And we can't make any leeway. So I thought, well, that's really unfortunate. I actually edited the film within 2 days. I found it very easy to edit because Jerry was a very good director. And rang the secretary, he says, you can call Jerry. Could you call Jerry in to come and have a look at the film? So we got it all set up on the editing machine, ready to go. I had my pad in my hand, ready to make notes, because I thought it's going to be several notes he's going to want, I'm sure, on this. And we looked at it, and there was a silence. So he looked at me, tapped me on the shoulder, and said, that's great, Roy. And walked out. And I couldn't believe it. So I said to Larry, my assistant, I said, is that it? He said, that's it, you've done it. And that was it. We didn't change any actual cuts on the film. All we did do was cut a short sequence out on whole. And that edit was the edit. And it reminded me, going back to Lawrence of Arabia, that I told you about, where the first edit was the edit. And you can only achieve that with experience, I believe, really, and luck. The person you're working with, and it's just that I gelled with Jerry, and I knew, really looking back now, what he wanted. I could read his mind, and he could read mine, and it was just a terrific relationship, and we kept in touch for 20 years, and we'd ring each other up and have a talk about film, and he was always very pleasant and excited to talk to, and very happy that I rang. I had his personal number. And even when he was trying to set up something else and wanted me to go back and do something for him, and it didn't come off, unfortunately. and I never got the opportunity to work with them again. But it was a wonderful, wonderful experience to work with someone that you admire so highly, that was appreciative to the work that you completed. And then after that, we had to record the music, so we went to Paris to record it because they had a French composer they wanted to work with. In fact, it was actually a French producer on the film as well. Recorded the music there, and it was great to see Jerry walking around the street, and all the children loved him there. He was the biggest star in the world in France, and he was like the Pied Piper with the children following him. It was just incredible. And I remember one day, one of my other favourite directors walks in, Jean-Luc Godard, and they're taking a photo of Jerry Lewis with Jean-Luc Godard. And I look back now, I think, oh, why didn't I ask them to take a photo of me there? I would have loved to have that to keep, you know, God almighty. So, and then about a month went by, a producer rang me up and said, can I go to the Philippines? Because they've got problems on a film there. So I went out there for a week and worked with the editor and re-edited the film, and they were all very happy. That was all for UNICEF, and it was very rewarding because it was for UNICEF. Albeit that I stayed at Caesar's Palace, which was incredible. And this is what happens in the movie industry. These things come out of the blue, and hopefully other people that are starting in the business will be rewarded in the same manner. Because it is very, very nice to achieve.
You worked as a production supervisor on a few pieces.
The first film was a Goldcrest film, To End All Wars, and it had come over to England because they'd run out of money. And Goldcrest had put up the post-production budget to complete the film, and I was brought in to supervise that because of my editing background. And that all went very well, so it was the first time I'd done it. And I seemed to get on with it okay. I was quite happy, they were happy. Might as well continue with this. So did a couple of more films, and then got involved with Millennium Films, who were very busy at the time, making about 12 films a year. And another, I get a call to come out and work in Thailand on Rambo, from a friend of mine that I've worked with on the previous Millennium films, with Jean-Claude Van Damme. So he wanted me to get a flight. That was on a Saturday, the next day. So I said, well, okay, it's for a week. So I said, okay, fine. So I just packed a small bag to go out for a week, and sorted the things out. And I remember arriving there at, I don't know what time I arrived there, but we had a meeting at midnight, Bangkok time, which is midnight in Los Angeles time as well. And the person I spoke to was someone which I'd grown associated with at Millennium in LA, and he was the head of post-production. And he said, we had about eight people around the table on this conference call. And he said, Roy, he said, God, he said, I'm so glad you're there. So I thought, well, that sounds good in front of all these people. So then we started talking the technical things. And so during that week, I sorted things out to a degree that I could do within that 1 week. And I got a call from the producer, and he said, can you stay on for 3 weeks? I said, well, yeah, okay, fine. So 3 weeks went by. Things were still going okay. It's a bit complicated because they were filming on Pattaya Island, and I was stationed in Bangkok, which was fine. And they put me up again. You know, I'd flown out there business class on Korean Airlines. That was lovely. And I was in a 5-star hotel in the middle of Bangkok. That was great. It was like a working holiday, in fact. So then the phone rings again. My friend comes back to me. Will you stay for 3 months? I said, oh my gosh, okay. So they were paying me a very good salary, all expenses and everything. So well, why not? I'm here. So I stayed for 3 months anyway, and we completed the work on the film. And it actually turned out to be a very good film. In fact, I thought it was, of all the Rambo films, actually it was the best one, I thought, besides the first one. It was very good as well. I've actually spoken a lot with students. I show them some rushes, I show them the completed film so they can see how it's all been put together. Next one I did after that was Killing Season with Robert De Niro and John Travolta, which was quite a good film, but it had a terrible ending. And they'd sent me a rough edit on DVD to look at. And this ending was on there. And I thought, oh no, how can you end a film like this? So I quickly went out to the producer and I said, are you on location still? He said, yes. I said, well, the ending, I said, on this film is diabolical. Can you shoot an alternate ending? Honestly, I'm telling you the truth. He said, I can't do that. I said, well, you've got an ending here that doesn't work. It really does not work. Well, I can't do anything about it. So, fine. So the film is as it is. And for anybody that sees it, I'm sure they'll agree with me that you can't end a film in such a manner.
You said that in Hong Kong, yes, that they worked to get stuff out a lot faster. So how do they do that compared to the UK?
Well, in Hong Kong, everything goes fast there, the speed of sound. You ask someone to do something, and it's done like lightning, that moment. Whereas in England or anywhere else, it might take 2 or 3 days for people to think about it, do it. In Hong Kong, it's said and it's done. They all get together, they work on it, and they pull it off. And just that the Chinese people are very fast workers. There's nothing, you know, nothing to stop them. They don't think about things, where everything in England is very slow in comparison, and it really gets done. And if I had the opportunity to bring, Chinese crew over here, I would bring them over, quite frankly, because I know the job would get done. It's a tenth of the time. If you have a music score already that you want to put visuals to, then you'll have the whole music track, which you can break down yourself, and then have visuals which will edit to the music track itself, which will be not dialogue sequences, of course, but purely visuals that will work with it. And the music track you choose for that you want to work with for your visuals, which you would have obviously had in your be scripted beforehand, will be applicable to the actual music itself, so that you know you're going to end up with something that will work together, the visual and the sound. But the most perfect example of any movie is probably one of the greatest movies of all time, and that's Jonathan Livingston Seagull, which is one of my favourite of all movies. Whereas they shot the whole movie, which was a 90-minute film. It's the most incredible story. It's purely about the seagull flying, but with a voiceover taking the place of thoughts of the seagull, a human voice. And then they had the film assembled together and decided they wanted to have songs on some of the scenes. And they asked Neil Diamond to write the songs, and he agreed. And the songs, the soundtrack on that is probably the most perfect example of any film I've ever seen, because they are the most beautiful songs that have ever been written. And they work so well. Neil Diamond has sort of visualized the whole process of the storyline and written both music and lyrics that work throughout the film and blend into it. And that's a very, very rare thing to happen. And for anybody starting off in the business, they should look at Jonathan Livingston Seagull. In fact, they should buy the book as well, because the book also preempts it all. And you can marry it up and see how they all work together, because it's a perfect example of a music achievement and a visual achievement in film.